Hello, welcome back. My name is Joshua Horrigan, Director of Industry Relations at the Chef's Academy. This is series two of a three-part series that we're cooking to help you entertain guests at your home a little easier with some amazing food. The second dish that we're going to be demonstrating today involves some fresh scallops with a parsnip puree and braised artichokes. The dish with the braised artichokes, we're cooking them, it's called Barigoule, artichokes Barigoule. Real simple way to braise them. The first thing that we have to do to prepare, to clean our artichokes is prepare an acidified water bath. And what that consists of, you take your lemon, roll the lemon on the board to loosen up some of the pulp in there, and then you take your knife, slice it through the center, and then you squeeze lemon juice into a tub with just water in it, cold tap water, and that's all you do. And what the lemon does in the water, the acid helps prevent these artichokes from browning. As quick as you can work on these artichokes is as fast as they brown. There's no way to really keep up with them. They brown real fast. So we've got your normal artichoke here. We're gonna pull some of these outside leaves off. And then take a vegetable peeler. And they make some vegetable peelers that have little grooves in them, and then they make some that are smooth. For something as tough and fibrous as a stem on an artichoke, I really prefer using these peelers that have the grooves. They have a little bit more of an aggressive blade, and you're just going to run that down the stem of your artichoke heart, getting the really dark green off. And you can see as I'm peeling away here, the color is going to more of a white. That's how you know you're getting down through the fiber. You get down to the lighter colored green part, then you can stop. You want to remove the bottom of that off, like so. Now we're going to take the top of this and basically just cut it off. You want to use a good, strong, sharp knife. You get it down to here. Now the choke part is this in the center, and they will actually make you choke. Artichoke hearts, these little hairs in here, they'll get in your throat, and they'll get stuck, and you'll be coughing, and it's not a pleasant thing. They're somewhat poisonous. They can cause indigestion. So you want to really make sure that you get those out of there. Peel a little bit more away from the outside there. Then get you a spoon that has kind of a thinner edge and really just scrape the inside of that out, and it'll peel out. Sometimes I prefer to just get your hand in there and scrape it. You can also split it straight down the middle, and it also makes it a little easier at times to get into that artichoke heart. But it's really important that this step is followed thoroughly. You want to make sure you get all of these little hairs out of the artichoke heart. You want to do this fairly quick. You want to make sure you've got your lemon water bath set up ahead of time so that as soon as you get these clean, you can drop them right in, because they do turn a really off color brown that you do not want. They'll turn a little bit darker as they cook. But overall, they stay green. See up in here where it's real dark green? We want to take our peeler again and cut some of that down. Now we've got a really nice looking artichoke here, half of an artichoke heart. Some of these leaves up on top still have a little of those hairs. So I'm going to take my knife and just run it across, trim it up one more time. Now I've got a really nice looking clean artichoke heart. And that's what you're going for. This is what you want right here. This is the finished product. So just to reiterate, take your whole artichoke here. You're gonna run your vegetable peeler down the sides of it to remove this fibrous stem. You wanna pull some of these leaves off to where you can get the angle of your vegetable peeler down into here. And you wanna remove that part. You don't wanna serve that to your guests. And then you're gonna cut this off, the top of it off, and remove all those chokes, the hearts. That's this center part in here. You can split it down the middle, and in here you'll see where the hairs start to go into the meat of the artichoke heart. That's where you're gonna insert your spoon and scrape out. You want the finished product to look like this, directly into your lemon bath. And that's where you'll let them sit. You wanna serve anywhere between two pieces or one whole artichoke per guest. Although they look very large on the store shelf when you're buying them, there's a lot of product with an artichoke that winds up in the trash can, unfortunately. There's other styles of presentation and cooking methods with artichoke, but in a classic Barigoule preparation, the artichoke heart is what you're serving your guest. And that's the most sought after part of an artichoke. It's the best part to eat. It requires the less work involved once it's been cleaned to that method. You know, once you break it down and it's that, all of that product that I just dropped into that water bath is fully edible. So your guests don't have to peel things off and eat them off the leaves and things like that. Your next step would be to prepare the mirepoix vegetables. Mirepoix is a French term described celery, carrots, and onions. And it's really the foundation of a lot of cooking stocks and flavor profiles in food across the board. Traditionally, your mirepoix between celery, carrots, and onion, 50% of it would be onion, 25% celery, and 25% carrot. So I've peeled our carrot, and we're just gonna cut that down fairly small, kind of like a medium dice. You wanna make sure you cut all of your vegetables in equal pieces so that they all cook at the same time. We've got our pan here. You want a deep pan that can braise. So finishing our mirepoix vegetables, we got the celery and carrots in our braising dish. We're gonna coarsely chop up just a simple white onion that we've removed the skin of. Now the next step is to caramelize these vegetables with a little bit of oil. You wanna get a nice golden color on the vegetables. That process takes about 30 minutes to do. So we're gonna skip over that, but it's a real simple method. You just put a little bit of oil on these vegetables, which I'm gonna do anyways. And you don't have to do this method, but I think that it really intensifies the flavors and makes a better braising liquid in the long run. So the next step, we're gonna put our artichoke hearts in the pan with our celery, carrots, and onion. We're gonna take 3 cloves of garlic and just crush them, kind of flatten them out with the side of our knife there. Put those in. And then we're gonna flood the pan, a little bit of chicken stock, and some white wine. Any dry white wine is fine. You don't have to use expensive wine. A little bit of stems of parsley. It's about 3 or 4 of those. And 2 sprigs of thyme. And a pinch of salt. And wrap this with foil if you're gonna place it into the oven and braise it. You can do that for about 1.5 hours. Check it every about 15 to 20 minutes to make sure the liquid isn't evaporating. You can do it on the stovetop as well. I prefer using the stove because I can kind of watch as they cook. To check the doneness of your artichoke hearts, you're gonna get some tongs because they'll be very hot. You don't wanna serve raw artichoke hearts to people. They're very fibrous. You pull the artichoke heart and you take your knife and you would insert it into the stem where it kind of meets the base of that artichoke heart. And if it slides in easy, like you would if it was a baked potato or a boiled carrot that you were gonna serve, that soft-like texture, that's what you're going for. And you're gonna place these artichokes right in the oven at about 350 degrees for about 1.5 hours. On the stove, it takes about 45 minutes. And that's what we have here. We've got these beautiful artichoke hearts that have been braising for about 45 minutes to 1 hour. As you can see, they did keep a nice green color. They do lose a little bit of color in cooking just through natural oxidation, but they're nice and tender. You know, they're not mushy, but they've got a great texture to them still, and I know the flavor is gonna be tremendous. So we're gonna allow those to just set in our braising liquid and cool for a moment before we serve them. And we wanna make sure we get our parsnips pureed down. And a parsnip looks a lot like a carrot, except they're white. It's a root vegetable. It's just as dense as a carrot. You would treat it just like you would a carrot. So you cut the ends off of it, and then you're gonna peel it. Once you get your parsnip peeled, cut them down small, kind of like a medium dice type cut. And we're gonna cook these in a liquid bath of about 3/4 chicken stock and 1/4 vitamin D whole milk. So you cut your parsnips up and you're gonna add them to a pan like so. You wanna get a good amount of them in there. We're gonna add a little bit of milk in that pan and then fill it up with chicken stock. Be careful when you cook these. Low and slow is the way to go. You don't want to crank the heat. Milk fats can burn. And when your milk fats burn, they'll turn a really dark brown and get extremely bitter. It's nothing that you want. We're going to take some garlic and just coarsely cut that. Add that into our braising liquid for a little flavor. Just do about 2 cloves in there. I would serve about a parsnip and a half per guest. As I said earlier, the recipes that are available online are for four portions. I'm gonna put a nice bunch of fresh thyme in there, and again, some parsley stems. Then I would take that, a little pinch of salt, set that right on top of the stove, medium low heat, and you let that simmer for about 30 to 40 minutes. The liquid will really reduce down. You wanna pull the stems out of it from the thyme. You want to pull them out from the parsley, many as you can, most of them cooked down. And you get this really nice, tender, aromatic parsnip. It's a beautiful root vegetable. Love them in the wintertime. Good, hearty food. Now, you could serve them just like this if you want. You could do a coarse mash with a hand masher like you could potatoes. I'm looking for a little bit smoother of a texture. So I'm gonna go ahead and go into our food processor with these. And this is for our parsnip puree. And then the braising liquid, you don't wanna add all of that initially because it can, you don't wanna make a runny parsnip puree. You can always add more. It's hard to thicken this concoction after it's already pureed and you've got too much liquid into it. Next we're gonna shave a little bit of Parmesan off with our peeler. I would say about 2 tablespoons worth. A Parmesan cheese is a salty cheese, so keep that in mind when it comes to seasoning with salt. You wouldn't want to use too much salt in this puree because Parmesan cheese is naturally salty already. We're gonna make our puree now. As you can see, it can use a little bit more liquid. So we're gonna stop it. Add a little bit more of those parsnip braising liquids, which was just cooked down milk and chicken stock. And just to add a little bit richness to it, I am gonna add some whole milk that hasn't been cooked with the braising liquid. I added about 2 tablespoons there. We're starting to get a really nice smooth puree here. I'm gonna kind of stir down the edges, make sure it all gets in there. Now, some of you that like those really rich, earthy flavors, parsnip is already naturally earthy. If you like, at this point, you could drizzle in a little truffle oil. It adds a bit of decadence, but truffle oil is very expensive, and it's definitely something that's not required to make this dish wonderful. It's just a little bit something extra that you could do. Some people do not like the smell of truffles at all. It is very earthy. So we've got our parsnip puree ready to go. The next step is to cook our scallops. Let's talk a little bit about scallops. There's all different types of scallops that you can get out there. There's diver scallops, which we're working with here. And that's really what that refers to is a method of harvesting. Rather than a mechanical harvester going down to the bottom of the ocean and dredging and pulling every scallop up that's down there, small, medium, and large, they actually send divers down to the bottom of the ocean and hand select each one. Thus the name diver scallop. Now the next thing you need to look at when you're shopping for scallops in your seafood department is what's called the U count. The U count is the unit count. How many of those pieces of product, whether it's a shrimp or a scallop or whatever, does it take to make up a pound? These scallops are U10s, meaning there are 10 of those scallops to make up a pound of them. So if we had U16 scallops, each one of our shrimp scallops would be about 1 ounce. You'll see that unit count applied to shrimp as well. 21 to 26, that means if you saw a shrimp with U21, 26, it would take 21 to 26 of those shrimp to make up a complete pound, okay? So we're working with U10 hand-picked diver scallops. Next, I wanna talk about how to prepare these scallops for cooking. And we've got these beautiful scallops. When you're looking at them through the seafood window, you really wanna look for a nice tight piece of meat. You don't wanna see splits in it. Not everyone's always gonna be perfect, but you can see here this scallop's kinda got a little crease in it. It's not the end of the world. That scallop's still very edible. It's still a beautiful product. But preferably, I like them when my scallops look like this and they're nice and uniform and smooth, kinda tight on all sides. The next thing you need to look for, you can ask your seafood monger to do this if you wish, is you wanna find out if they've been cleaned. You wanna remove this little beard here. It's a little side muscle that attaches this scallop inside the shell. And you just remove that. Some people leave them on, but in finer establishments, you wanna remove that. And I'd recommend removing it myself. You serve two of these diver handpicked U10 scallops per guest. Depending on what scallops you get, how big they are, that's really what's gonna dictate how many scallops you wanna serve a guest. But having that we have, you know, four courses, including the appetizer that we started with, I think two scallops is adequate. Season them by hand, one at a time. Don't just season from up here all over the place. Get down above the scallops and evenly make sure you distribute that salt all across the surface area of that scallop. Okay, now we've got our kosher salt on top of the scallop. We're gonna come over to our pan. We've already got a pan that's hot. We're gonna add a little bit of olive oil. If you use extra virgin, don't crank your heat up too high, because extra virgin has a lot of natural olive products in it that can burn very easily, and when oil burns, it becomes bitter, and that's not anything you want to serve to your guests. Now, when you're talking about cooking scallops, part of the presentation is the caramelization that you get on top of these scallops. Scallops have a flat surface on the top and the bottom, usually. If they're, you know, as they sit, they tend to kind of get a little lopsided, but you want to set the flattest side you can find on the scallop in the pan first. And when I cook scallops, I cook by a rule of thumb that I call the 80-20. 80% of my cook time is on the first side. And that's the side that I'm gonna serve up on the plate. That's the presentation side. So to reiterate, the presentation side of my scallop is what I'm cooking first. There's scallops in this pan with the hot oil and they're cooking. When I turn these over, that's the side that I'm gonna keep up on the plate that I serve our guests. These scallops do not take long at all to cook. Maybe 3 minutes on one side. Another real important tool that I recommend getting when you're cooking scallops or really any seafood, to me this is pretty standard in most kitchens. I think every home cook should have this. It's a fish spatula. It's a little different than most spatulas. You're gonna see an angle at the end of it. If you put it into a pan, it's very flexible and forgiving. It's made to gently lift the fish or the scallop, whatever it is that you're cooking, off the base of that pan without it tearing. Now, a lot of people like to take their spatula or their tongs and they'll shake, turn the scallops. Don't do that. That's not going to allow you to get the cauterization you're looking for. You're not going to get that brown caramelization crust that you really want for a presentation factor. Maybe 3 minutes on each side. It does not take real long to cook sea scallops. The worst thing you can do is overcook sea scallops. They become rubbery, like little balls. You could throw them in this kitchen and they'd still be bouncing around an hour later. Nobody wants to eat that. I'm gonna come over here and show you what you're looking for. When you're doing these scallops, see that nice brown cauterization? That's the proteins that have cooked against that hot, flat surface in the bottom of the pan. Had I sat there and shook the pan, jiggled the scallop with my tongs, I would not have had that nice, even cauterization, that color that is so sought after. Well, now that our scallops have finished cooking, I'm gonna bring them over here, get them out of that hot pan, and let them rest for a minute. If you leave them in that pan, they're gonna continue to cook, and you're gonna have an overcooked scallop on your hands. It's not something you wanna serve your guests. So we're gonna let those rest for a moment, and we're gonna go ahead and plate. The first step to this dish is putting the parsnip puree on the plate. I'm gonna do that by putting a nice mound directly in the center of each plate. Have a towel handy just in case you drop on the edges. You wanna wipe that off as much as possible. Next step is to kind of mold our puree into a strip, kind of like a elongated strip down the center of the plate. And that's gonna be like a little bed for those scallops to sit on top of. And you're gonna leave a nice amount of space on both sides and in the center, because we're gonna alternate the artichokes, these beautiful braised artichokes that we cooked earlier. really, I think the size of our artichokes today, we're gonna go ahead and just keep one per plate. Or if you get some that are smaller, you can always take the half of artichoke heart, kind of cut it down the middle, plate it like that. Now these artichoke hearts will need to be seasoned. When you remove them from the braising liquid, you're gonna wanna season the artichoke hearts. It's very important. Just like you did the scallops, directly over them. Now we're gonna finish the plate, a little bit of freshly chopped Italian flat-leaf parsley. Not a lot. And then just a little bit of the braising liquids from those artichokes. You're just gonna spoon that right over those scallops, okay? And then you're gonna take your vegetable peeler, make some ribbons of Parmesan cheese. You're just gonna crumble that over the top of these. And again, remember, Parmesan cheese is a little salty, so you didn't have to use that much salt on those artichoke hearts. And if you like, you can take the carrots and the celery out, spread that around the plate if needed. I'm gonna refrain from that. Remember, we still have a beef course and dessert to go after that. So here you have it. You've got the seared diver handpicked sea scallops with a parsnip puree and artichokes barigoule. It's a wonderful seafood course. I'd pair this with an unoaked Sauvignon Blanc or a lightly oaked California Chardonnay. It'd work very well. Thank you for joining me for the second portion of this cooking demonstration. We will be back next with our beef braciole. It's a classic Southern Italian dish. Stay tuned.